Hello everyone, I'm Miss Trish. I'm one of the RE teachers for UU St. Petersburg, and I'm here with the session for the 21st of February, 2021. This session is entitled, Where Wounds Are Healed, and I'll light the chalice and get started. Love is the spirit of this church and service its law. This is our great covenant. To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. When it comes to beloved community, we focus on creating a place where wounds are healed and wrongs are righted. Our faith has taken up this work and called on UUs to build a world without racism. A large part of this is creating a new way of being together. But we also need to focus on healing old and existing wounds that linger. So what's one of the ways our faith guides us into becoming a people of beloved community? It asks, acknowledge and heal the wounds that racism has caused. And I have an object of reflection here. It's a Band-Aid, which, of course, we put on cuts and wounds. And unfortunately, there's no Band-Aid like this one for racism. People are treated differently based on the color of their skin, and these different standards are unfair. They've caused wounds to people of color. Unfairness and racism are part of the history of the Black people in this country, as well as the histories of other races, like Latinx, Native American, and Asian. Since this is Black History Month, we are especially thinking about racism involving African Americans. And here's one story from a man who is a Black doctor. This happened to him when he was 7 years old, and he tells this story of wanting to be a part of a space story. He said, "You can't be Han Solo from Star Wars. You're Black." It hit me out of nowhere. I was so confused. I mean, my skin was certainly darker than anyone else's in the group, but since when was that going to stop the game about space aliens? I assumed they sensed my confusion and offered me the role as Lando instead, because he looked more like you, they said. It was the day that my mother explained racism to me. Three of the ways to heal racism, or to put a Band-Aid on racism, are to notice differences and to celebrate them, or to say, "I see what's happening and it's not fair." Don't let the wound continue to happen. Or fix the system that caused the personal wounds. The rest of our session will explore these three ways that we can help. One of the ways to heal the wounds of racism is to fix the system that caused the personal pain. And I'm going to read you a parable, which is sometimes called Babies in the River or Upstream Downstream. And it's about fixing the system that causes wounds or causes babies in the river, which is called upstream thinking. And we'll include links so that you can read it yourself, and also a link to another story that you might find helpful. Babies in the River is based on variously attributed tales, including those of Saul Alinsky and Irving Zola. It goes like this. Once upon a time, there was a small village on the edge of a river. Life in the village was very busy. There were people growing food and teaching children to make blankets and people making meals. One day, a villager took a break from harvesting food and noticed a baby floating down the river towards the village. She couldn't believe her eyes. She heard crying in the distance and looked downstream to see that two other babies had already floated by the village. She looked around at the other villagers working nearby. "Does anyone else see that baby?" she asked. One village woman heard her, but continued working. "Yes," yelled a man who'd been making soup. "Oh, this is terrible," a woman said who had been building a campfire. "Look, there are even more upstream." Indeed, there were three more babies coming around the bend. "How long have these babies been floating by?" asked another villager. No one knew for sure, but someone thought they might have been in the river some time earlier. They were busy at the time and didn't have time to investigate. They quickly organized themselves to rescue the babies. Watchtowers were built on both sides of the shore, and swimmers were coordinated to maintain shifts of rescue teams that watched for 24-hour surveillances over the river. Zip lines with baskets were attached and stretched across the river to get even more babies to safety quickly. The number of babies that floated down the river only seemed to increase. The villagers built orphanages, and they taught even more children to make blankets, and they increased the amount of food they grew to keep the babies housed and warm and fed. Life in the village carried on. Then one day, a meeting of village council, a villager asked, "But where are all these babies coming from?" "No one knows," said another villager. "But I say we organize a team and go upstream and find out who's throwing these babies in the river." Not everyone was in agreement. "But we need to help the people to pull these babies out of the river," one villager said. "That's right," said another villager. "And who will be here to cook for them and to look after them if a bunch of us go upstream?" The council chose to let the village decide. So, if you were a villager in this village, what would you vote? Would you send a team upstream or keep everyone back in the village trying to put band-aids on the problems that were floating downstream? In this story, it's just as important to go upstream and fix the system as it is to catch the babies that are floating downstream because they're being tossed in the river. The babies floating downstream is just a symptom of a bad situation upriver, like some kind of a wound. So what could we do if you imagined yourself to be in that situation? What could you do to help the people to heal the wound? Bad wounds are happening even as we speak, and people are resisting and calling for change. Small steps are important. They're just as important as big steps, because big steps begin with small steps, and we can all take part. So if you have someone there to talk with, you can pause the video for a moment and talk about what you think this story of babies in the river means and how it relates to our task to erase racism in our lifetimes. I'm going to hand the microphone over to Miss Janae, and she's going to finish up the session, but we will include some links for you to watch or read so that you can think about this even more. So until next time, I love you and miss you all, and I wish you wealth, health, and happiness, and lots of good thinking on how you can help. Namaste. See you next time. Bye.